お待たせしました。ベアトリス・ピン・アイキャン事務局長による基調講演、演題は Please shall not repeat the evil How Japan can lead us towards a nuclear free world です。ピン事務局長、よろしくお願いいたします。
and wherever they might be, as well as their families who have also carried their stories. The people of Hiroshima that came after them and carried with them their stories of survival. Please join me in honoring, celebrating, and thanking them for being tireless voices of truth. But it's not just the Hibakusha that know the truth. Not just the people that lived through the experience and rebuilt this city from the ashes that know this. The young people that I've met here also carry the stories with them and carry the passion to make sure that this is never done again. And that makes me really happy, because in many ways, ICANN is a youth-led movement. And traditionally, that was the case on nuclear disarmament. The first people to speak out against nuclear weapons were an older generation, scientists, intellectuals, academics, many of those who have worked on creating the nuclear bomb, but regretted it as soon as they realized the destructive power of the thing they had created. The first ever petition against nuclear weapons was from 70 scientists who had worked on the Manhattan Project to build the first nuclear bomb. But over 70 years later, the problem has not been solved. We are not free from the threat of just one person, for example, holding the power to end their world in their hands. So, it falls to a new generation to solve the problem that the previous generation did not. And you, the youth here today, are that generation. And having met so many young people here, it gives me really great hope and the optimism that we will succeed. These cities, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, are cities of hope. They have emerged from the ashes of nuclear darkness to become beacons of light for the rest of the world. And it inspires me that we can do the same with this campaign to ban nuclear weapons and make every state silent. A global problem needs a global solution. And the responsibility falls in particular on the youth to drive this solution. And the reason why I am so optimistic that we will succeed is that young people have three incredibly powerful weapons that are nearly impossible to stop once they combine. And those secret weapons is hope, energy, and social media. Because hope is what drives us to do this work. Fear has guided global relations for 70 years. And the powerful created nuclear weapons to control the world. But it's clear that these weapons have controlled us. And the antidote of fear is hope. And young people must harness our hope if we are going to succeed. And we will do that so using our second secret weapon, energy. I'm really inspired to see the energy that young people bring to this movement. It can be hard when you see people who have been working on this issue for decades, when people tell you day after day that you're being naive, that you're trying to achieve is impossible. But the young people in this movement have overcome that pessimism with their energy. And they're bringing new hope and bring new life into the issue, as well as with new ideas and innovation. And the third secret weapon is what could be the difference, social media. Young people don't just have a hope and energy to come up with great ideas. They have today the technology to connect those ideas to other like-minded people around the world to join forces. Together, we are more powerful. And social media allows us to connect. An ICANN campaigner here in Hiroshima can share his or her ideas with an ICANN campaigner in Mexico that they never met. And they can connect with another ICANN campaigner in, say, Indonesia. And all three of them can reach and inspire a young person in, for example, my home country, Sweden, who has never heard of ICANN, but cares about this issue. And this group can then get in direct contact with their politicians and tell them to sign this treaty. Hope, energy, and connecting over social media is a powerful combination. And we all deserve a say in the continued existence of nuclear weapons. Just look at the unfortunate people in Hawaii this weekend, who for 30 minutes thought they were going to die after a false alert saying a nuclear missile was about to hit. They said goodbye to their loved ones, raised home to their children, waited in terror. Those people deserve to stay in the system that makes them live in fear. And we all have the right to speak up against this. And that has been a large part of ICANN's mission, to bring democracy to disarmament. Nuclear weapons are, by their very nature, and the structures we have put in place, authoritarian. Their use betrays humanity. Their continued development betrays reason. And their stockpiling betrays democracy. And any democratic country that supports their continued use is betraying democracy too. Nuclear weapons are the great contradiction of our time. They are the paradox that promises peace by proposing destruction. It's a dangerous balance that cannot hold forever. We must confront this if we are the ones to write the end of the story that began with this city, the end of nuclear weapons. And if we shy away, if we live in denial, if we leave the outcome to others, the weapons will write the end of the story. And it could be the end of us all. And this city is a very appropriate place to discuss the contradictions of the nuclear age. They were in many ways born here and embodied in the inhabitants of the city, past and present. As I mentioned before, it is here that we saw the very worst of humanity, where the bomb with the dreadfully comic codename Little Boy was dropped on unsuspecting citizens. A new type of destruction was brought to bear, which ushered in a new age of terror, and ironically robbed the world of potential peace. Rather than ending World War II and forging an era of stability and rebuilding, the bombings guaranteed decades of proxy conflict and constant flirtations in total disaster. We were set on a path, an arms race, into total destruction. But this is not a city that just serves as a warning. Hiroshima did not recede into dust like Pompeii after the volcano. No, Hiroshima rose. Hiroshima is alive today. And the memory of what was before and what came after the bomb was held and guarded by the survivors. And you and your ancestors rebuilt. The people of Hiroshima counted the worst of humanity with the best. And in doing so, we can definitely say that Hiroshima became a city of hope. And I believe in the power of collective humanity to stand together and face down any threat. And I believe that we will overcome the destructive force and threat of nuclear weapons once and for all. Otherwise, I would not be doing this work. And some people may say that makes me an idealist. I'm okay with that. We are idealists, but we are not naive. Because we know that the vast majority of the world wants to solve the nuclear problem, not to develop more nuclear weapons and expand the nuclear threat. We are idealists who believe against all odds that the new Japan Treaty would be a reality. And we are idealists who know that our role as campaigners is to make that that seems impossible, inevitable. And idealism is not foolhardy. It is necessary and desperately called for at this moment in the story of humankind and nuclear weapons. And the truth that the critics of our movement simply cannot face is that their belief in the ability of nuclear weapons to prevent conflict simply defies reason. That nuclear weapons have not been used in conflicts since they were used in this city and on Nagasaki does not have to do with prudent leadership, but good fortune. And we cannot simply wait for our luck to run out. If you ask a mathematician, they will tell you that the likelihood of nuclear weapons being used at any given time is greater than zero. That means that given enough time, it is certain that nuclear weapons will be used again. And let me then ask this question to those who accuse us of being naive or irrational. If you know that this story will end either with the use of nuclear weapons or their elimination, who is the irrational one? We are not naive. We are not irrational. We are on the side of humanity and the survival of the human race. We simply cannot bear to do nothing, because doing nothing is accepting the eventual use of nuclear weapons. And the fact remains that as long as nuclear weapons exist in any form, the clock is now counting down to the moment of their use. The need to act is urgent. And you here in Hiroshima, the people in this room, your friends, families, neighbors, you all have a unique role to play in leading the rest of the world towards a nuclear-free future. You are essential characters in this story, and your voices and unique moral authority are needed. And I think most of you all understand that. And that's why you have erected monuments, like where we are today, the powerful Memorial Park, as a warning bell to others to not forget the lessons of history. And that is why this community shares the story of that fateful day in 1945. And that's why you tell your children the truth of what happened here. And that's why you have inscriptions like one just outside that states, "We shall not repeat this evil." And you all know that. But there is one particular audience that needs to hear that message. One group of people that must be encouraged to share the values of the people from Hiroshima. And that is your government in Tokyo. The Japanese government should know better than any nation the consequences of nuclear weapons. Yet Tokyo is happy to live under the threat to use nuclear weapons under the US nuclear protection and has not yet joined the treaty to prohibit nuclear weapons. Is your government okay with repeating the evil that was done to Hiroshima and Nagasaki to other cities? As long as your government believes in the effect of deterrence, they are encouraging nuclear proliferation. And along with other nations living under the protection of nuclear alliances, are moving the world closer to the use of nuclear weapons. There is a large gap between the values represented in Hiroshima and Nagasaki and the policy coming out of Tokyo. And we must close that gap. We must harness your voices to show your national government in Tokyo that it's unacceptable to be a willing participant in this nuclear use. But Japan must be a leader in the global movement for nuclear disarmament. But Japan must join the treaty. answerable to the wishes of its people. If you can unite your fellow citizens in one clear voice, it will be impossible for your government to ignore. The people of Hiroshima are a moral authority on this issue. And Japan can be a moral authority as a nation to know firsthand the consequences of nuclear war. So encourage your politicians to take up this cause. And if they don't listen, grow louder. Know that you have millions of people around the world who share your values and support your cause. And join with them to create an unstoppable force for democratic disarmament. Because that grassroots power is what led to the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, even when those in power said it was impossible. And with this treaty, we have the framework to create a new international norm that calls these weapons not a symbol of power, but a symbol of shame. And they said banning chemical weapons was impossible, biological weapons, landmines, cluster munitions, but we banned them. For far too long, your government has lived in its own contradiction. Multiple prime ministers have spoken of the values of Hiroshima. They have claimed that nuclear abolition is a government priority, claimed the mantle of moral leadership unique to the only country to be attacked with atomic weapons. They speak of the unspeakable horrors of nuclear war. But now that we have a treaty to stop that from becoming a reality, they will not own it. They always say something hard is impossible. But ICAN campaigners show that it can be made a reality if there's enough of us calling for change loud enough. Governments answer to people. People know that nuclear weapons do not make sense, and they are demanding change. With the nuclear ban treaty, a reality that was endorsed by the majority of nation states in the world, Japan, a country that should be a leader on this issue, is out of step with the modern and rational world. The time for words without deeds is past. We need action and leadership in Japan. And the world needs you, the citizens of this city, of this country, to demand it. And that is how the people of Hiroshima can ask for more from the government in Tokyo. And that is how Tokyo should be standing up for nuclear disarmament among the community of nations. But Japan is also unique in debate for another reason. Just across the border, North Korea is threatening destruction and devastation with its nuclear program. And once more, Japan could be in the crosshairs of a nuclear attack. But rather than provoking fear and having us rush to the conclusion that we need more nuclear weapons, better nuclear weapons, bigger nuclear weapons, it should give us pause to think, will we ever be free from this threat, as long as there are nuclear weapons anywhere? These weapons lead us closer to war. 15,000 nuclear weapons did nothing to deter North Korea from developing their own nuclear weapons. And we should not be relying on cool heads only, being the one thing that stops us from using it. If you are uncomfortable with Kim Jong-un or Donald Trump having the power to destroy us all, then you are uncomfortable with nuclear weapons. Without nuclear weapons, would the United States be defenseless against North Korea? Of course it would not. And the United States having nuclear weapons, Japan relying on nuclear weapons to protect them, has done nothing to stop North Korea's nuclear ambitions. It has only fueled it. So, we have a solution to the North Korean situation, and luckily it solves all the other problems too. We all join the treaty to prohibit nuclear weapons. We eliminate nuclear weapons. History shows that the provision of certain types of weapons facilitates progress towards elimination. Weapons that have been outlawed by international treaties are increasingly seen as illegitimate, lose the political status. Arms companies find it more difficult to acquire funds to work on illegal weapons, and such work then carries a significant reputational risk. Banks, pension funds, other financial institutions can divest from these producers. Changing the rules regarding nuclear weapons will have major impact even beyond those nations that formally adopt the treaty at the outset. And we are an international campaign, but every action is local. And we have hundreds of groups active around the world, and we will be helping them to resource efforts to convince their national governments to ratify this treaty and create a pathway to complete nuclear disarmament. And the need has never been so urgent as now, especially with news this week from the Trump administration in the United States. And we have just seen a leaked copy of the new US policy on nuclear weapons. And what it contains in that review should deeply worry us all. It has revealed that the United States, instead of making progress towards disarmament, instead of admitting failure of deterrence and forging a new safer reality, they are wanting to increase their nuclear weapons stockpile and create new low-yield weapons that they say will make them more likely to use. Their concern is that the existing nuclear weapons are too big, too deadly to use. But here's the problem with that thinking. By today's terms, nuclear bombs that destroyed Hiroshima and Nagasaki were very low yield. Just one Trident submarine, for example, carries 70 times the destructive power of what was dropped here in 1945. 70 times. So what the US officials are saying is that they consider what happened here in Hiroshima to be minor. They are worried that their potential enemies will think that they are too concerned to drop a bigger bomb. They wouldn't think twice about dropping bombs like the one destroyed this city. They wouldn't think twice about causing another Hiroshima. And it is up to the people of Hiroshima, especially the young people, reaching out to other young people around the world to tell the story of what happened here, or else people around the world would think what happened here was minor and is likely to happen again. It is up to the people around the world to share your stories with their own people, so their own governments do not buy into this dangerous thinking that insults the memory of Hiroshima and all the victims of nuclear attacks. And it can sometimes be a sobering and depressing topic to talk so much about the end of the world through nuclear Armageddon. It can be scary to think about the threat that we constantly live under, where at a moment without any notice, life as we know it could end. But the sky could rain down destruction one morning, just as it did here 73 years ago. But we have hope. And I want to finish here today by talking to you about my hope. I can hope that we will see the end of nuclear weapons. We should be afraid of these weapons. Fear is rational. The threat is real. And we are closer than any time in recent history to the use of nuclear weapons. And we are shockingly seeing the near daily threats between countries to wipe each other off the map. We are so close to the war of words becoming a war of weapons. But we are also closer than ever to their elimination. We have much cause to be hopeful, to defeat fear with hope. Because 122 countries adopted the treaty to prohibit nuclear weapons last year at the United Nations. And that is a vast majority of states in the world. And while we are closer than ever to prohibit and eliminate nuclear weapons totally, there is still much work to do. We live in democracies, so there is always a choice. If our political leaders refuse to join us on the side of hope, on the side of rationality, on the side of a future, then we must elect different leaders who will. If our countries refuse to join this treaty, then we must grow louder until we are impossible to ignore. We must make those countries that live under the protection of nuclear weapons isolated on the world stage, and the countries that possess these weapons surrounded by shame and stigma. What happened in Hiroshima must not be forgotten, and you have such an important part to play. Nagasaki and Hiroshima have a unique place in history, and our challenge is to make sure that they remain unique, that there are no more cities that join Hiroshima in the list of nuclear bomb sites, that there are no more Hibakusha. Your values must become Tokyo's values, and that must become the world's values. Your voices must ring out of this hall to be heard around the world, to join with other voices calling for common sense and hope. It is up to young people like yourself to defeat these new weapons with your own weapons, your hope, your energy, and the connections with others who share your passion on social media. ICAN wants to harness your energy and your passion and your hope. And if you want to join us, you can go and find us on nuclearbad.org, on social media like Facebook or Twitter, or whatever the cool kids are using these days. And connect us, connect with us, connect with other young people around the world. And that hope is the hope for a better future. That is what we deserve. And that is what we should expect of our political leaders. Let them know that is what you expect. And use your voice to abolish nuclear weapons. And I look forward to working with the city of Hiroshima and the people of Hiroshima, and particularly the young people of Hiroshima, to achieve that. Thank you.